Look how steep our steps are. That's our room there. These steps are so steep.
Good morning. We're up early and we're just having breakfast down in the restaurant attached to our hotel.
Stephen has gone for the beans on toast. Nice.
I've gone for a veggie breakfast. Mine isn't here yet, but it'll be here soon. We are going out today to, it's going to be a kind of sad vlog today, I think, because we're going to the killing field, which I'll tell you more about as we go along. First of all, we're going to, there's a museum, which is called S21, that we're going to first, and then we're going to the killing field, which are, I don't know, maybe 10 kilometres outside of the city.
You can't really see this, but this is just literally at the end of our street, and this is the Museum of Cambodia, and oh my goodness, it is an amazing building. Look, here's a better view. There's a little gate. Look at that. That is amazing. I think we're just walking along, and I think that this might be the museum, the S21. So we're going to try and find the entrance. It looks harrowing. See all the barbed wire at the front here? Yeah, look, here's the gate. The entrance must be round the other side. Here we go, here is the entrance. Okay, we are inside, we've got our audio guide. It's $6 to get in, or $3 without an audio guide. But kids are free of charge, so it was $6 for me, $3 for Stephen. We're gonna listen to some of this stuff. I'll talk to you more about what this place is as we go around. Give you a brief little history. So this place used to be a school, and Cambodia was taken over in 1975, I think, by the Khmer Rouge, who captured people and brought them here and tortured them, killed them. And this site is kind of all about, you know, what happened here, and it's obviously a very kind of sad place to be, and yeah, we're trying to find out more about it. During the time that the Khmer Rouge was in power, they brought, I think it said on the audio guide, something like between 12 and 20,000 people came here to be tortured and killed. A lot of people are buried here, and then after about a year or so, I think that the grounds weren't big enough, and that's where the killing fields come in, which we'll be visiting later on, where they went and then took bodies out there. So this is a very, you know, it's not a nice place to be, but it's an important part of Cambodian history. They also said that there were only 12 survivors, the people that were brought here. So these 14 white graves are the last 14 people to die here. When the place was finally taken over, they came in and found 14 bodies that had been, they were being interrogated and they'd been murdered and just left there. And so they cremated the bodies. There was no way of telling who they were, apparently. So they cremated the bodies and they put up these 14 graves for them. Building A, and this is where important people got taken to be tortured. They blocked up, as you can see up there at the top, they have, when it was, it used to be a school, they had air ventilations, but they blocked up the air ventilations when they turned into a prison. Inside these rooms is an iron bed where prisoners were chained to and tortured, and yeah, it's all pretty nasty stuff. We're gonna go inside the rooms now. Are the 10 rules that were enforced for the prisoners. Just take a read of them. That one, whilst getting lashes or electrification, you must not cry at all. Yeah. So they tortured these people to try and get confessions out of them, and a lot of them just gave false confessions just to stop the torture, and they gave up family members' names and things. just to, the Khmer Rouge was trying to find anyone that obviously opposed their rule. My understanding of it so far is that when they took over, anyone with any form of education, that was the kind of people that were brought in. They didn't want anyone that maybe would threaten their leadership, so they were the kind of people that they brought in. They would get they wanted everyone out of the cities into like doing farm work and things. We're up on the second floor now. This is one of the torture rooms. There's some pretty awful pictures in most of the rooms. Very much kind of a secret. They went and arrested, like I said before, doctors, teachers, you know, anyone with an education. They went and arrested them like in the night, brought them here in trucks, and they didn't know they were coming here. Nobody kind of knew what this place was. It was all very much sort of top secret, that what went on behind closed doors, I suppose. This wooden structure here, this was here when it was a school. Kids used it for playing and climbing and stuff. But then obviously when it became a prison, they didn't use it for executions, they used it for torture. So just heard an account on the audio that they were pulled up to the top by a rope, and then when they passed out, they were dunked into these big jars here that contained human waste and dirty water. This is building C, and as you can see, they've added barbed wire all the way up on the three different floors. That's because somebody committed suicide from the top level up there, and they didn't want them to commit suicide. Obviously they wanted their signed confessions, so they've put barbed wire across it all so they couldn't commit suicide. These are all single cells in here. They used to be obviously old classrooms. They were adapted into single cells where prisoners were kept, and then they were taken over to building one where the interrogation room was, maybe up to like three times a day. So these are all the cells. So they knocked a hole through, so these were all separate classrooms, and they knocked a hole through them all so the guards could keep an eye on all the single cells. This is the memorial in the centre of the courtyard, and they've got plaques all around with everyone's name that was imprisoned here and tortured and killed. We are finished at S21. I don't know how well I've kind of explained what's been going on as we've been going around and what this place is all about, but we're just going to have a little relax for a little bit, and then we're going to go off to the killing fields, I think. Okay, so this guy here is Chung Mei, one of the seven survivors of this place.
Yep.
Stephen's enjoying his little tuk-tuk ride. No, you're not, you just banged your head. Okay, we have arrived. The genocidal centre, this is the killing fields. This place was used when the S21, the prison that we've just been to, when that was kind of full of
it was no longer could take any more bodies. I think I've just read there was over 300. Yeah, this is the most well known, but there was over 300 of these killing fields throughout Cambodia, where people were taken falsely and, you know, killed after giving, after they were forced into giving false confessions for crime. They were brought here and killed. There's mass graves here, and it's pretty horrific. So just be aware of that. This is not a fun vlog, as you've already seen. 3 million out of the 8 million Cambodians around at the time were killed during this period. Lots of them were obviously tortured and murdered at these places, but also lots of them died from being overworked. Brief history of it, I don't think I've explained that Pol Pot wanted to kind of start off at year zero. He wanted to take, I kind of said about the educated people, take all the educated people, everyone out of the cities and get them into the country working on farms, on rice farms and agriculture and all of that. And he wanted to get rid of all like different levels of society, like classes and things. So that was what he was trying to do. And so things like if you wore glasses, if you had smooth hands, you're probably going to be taken into S21 or areas like that around Cambodia, prisons like that, to be interrogated. 3 in every 8 were killed. That's just crazy. Like, even, you know, through either being murdered or through overwork. Right, come on. We were driven here in trucks in the middle of the night, blindfolded, and about a truck every 3 weeks or so would come with some prisoners to be killed, and normally they would be killed on the day they arrived, but towards the end a truck would arrive every day with about 300 people that they were gonna kill here and bury. And obviously they couldn't do that many, like, kill that many people in one day, so they would hold them in the rooms. I've showed you some signs that because the buildings no longer exist that they were held in, they were torn down, so they were held there for a short while waiting to be killed, basically. On this tree here, the stems have got little spikes on that are really sharp, and they were used to cut prisoners' throats. They used DDT chemicals to pour over the graves, because sometimes, one, the pure stench of the bodies, you can imagine, like, you know, tens and tens of bodies in this mass grave, it's gonna stink, and it would get rid of the smell, drown out the smell. And also, if sometimes they were thrown in there, people were thrown in there not quite dead, and so they'd throw the chemicals in to kind of finish the job. Here is one of the mass graves. Area here, it's got a walkway along it, because underneath here, this is where there's lots of graves, and when the weather is particularly bad, when it rains a lot, bones and teeth and things surface. In fact, over here, just spotted some what looks like teeth in the soil there. Yeah, you can see it in there. Not nice. So this area was actually an orchard before it was turned into the killing fields. The people that were driven out of the cities to go and farm, they didn't know how to farm. They didn't have a clue about, you know, how to farm rice, whatever. They worked in cities, and Pol Pot's ordered that rice production was tripled, which was just an impossible task because these people didn't know what they were doing, which obviously then led to them working, you know, 12, 18 hour days with hardly any food. They didn't have any of their possessions. They were all took off them, but they were just like their clothes on their back and a little bowl for some rice that they were given twice a day. As you can see, there's like kids' clothes in there. So after the Khmer Rouge was kind of overthrown in Cambodia, they were actually given a seat at the UN. That is astounding, that the people who were responsible for all of this had a seat at the UN. That's scary. I can just see overhead the killing tree, which is where babies and children were killed. This is not nice at all. So the killing tree is in the background there. We've just listened to the audio about it and it said that when they first discovered this place and first discovered that tree, there was blood on the tree and bits of brain, and the guards would grab babies' legs and hit them, hit them against the tree, kill them and then throw them into the grave. And one of the reasons, like, why kill babies, why kill children, was that one of the kind of the mottos of the Khmer Rouge was like, to kill a tree you have to pull out the roots or something, so that they didn't leave any family member. If they killed one member of the family, they would kill them all, because then if there was one left, they would maybe come back and seek revenge. These are some more of the mass graves down here. This is the stupa, which is a memorial built here, and inside is lots of skulls and bones, I think, which they are using to try and like figure out more information about what went on here. They're categorized into like how they were killed, if they've got a split down their skull, and or they've got a hole in the skull, and what they were killed with and stuff. So I'm gonna go in and take a little look. Oh my goodness. Pretty odd experience being there with all those skulls that they were categorised with how they were killed. They weren't killed with bullets. Bullets were too expensive, so it was and too loud. And yeah, so they were. It was just farm tools, bamboo sticks, anything like that. Cleaning rod. That was, yeah, things like that. Nice. Yeah. We're finished. We're heading back into the city now. Gotta go and find our tuk-tuk driver out here somewhere. Where you sit in that way? No. There's definitely a lot more cars here in Cambodia than Vietnam. A hell of a lot, and like 4x4s as well. Look at it. Okay, we went back to the hotel for a little bit. As you can see, it started to get dark. I have edited the vlog, I have done all my work that I need to do, so now we're going to explore Phnom Penh in the dark. This is where the strongmen hang out. Check them all out.
Whoa, I wish I could do that.
We've just wandered down to the river area. Wow, it's a really wide river. Wow, yeah, look at the hotel. Wow. Aerobics and stuff, gym classes. Our plan is that we are looking for a restaurant. We're going to have some tea. We are going to the night market, is this way. I'm very close because I've changed settings on my camera and it's like a bit too close to me. But never mind. Yeah, night market is this way, and so on our way up, we're going to try and find somewhere to have a little bit of tea because we haven't eaten since our breakfast this morning. Although that was a big breakfast, we're quite hungry now because it's maybe like, you're not hungry. This kid never gets hungry. We have eaten tea and we're just off to the night market. We are night market. Looks like it's closing down, to be honest. We've just got home. I am gonna end the vlog because I've got a ton of stuff to do. Busy morning, maybe tomorrow morning if we can get up in time to do the things that we want to do before we leave Phnom Penh, because we are leaving tomorrow. And I think I would really, really like it here. I don't know whether I'm saying I really, really like it because I'm not staying. It's one of them like you want more because you can't have it. But anyway, I am gonna go. So thank you so much for watching. I know it's not been a massively full of laughs vlog, but it's been a important vlog in terms of Cambodian history, and I think I possibly might talk more about this tomorrow because it really kind of affected me today and seeing the things that we saw. But anyway, thank you for watching and I'll see you tomorrow. Good night.